title of my message today is The Mystery of Money. One verse of scripture to open up with, Ecclesiastes 10:19. Bread is made for laughter and wine gladdens life, and money answers everything. Let's pray. God, we thank you for a deeper understanding of what the Bible says about the meaning of money, the making of money, and the management of money as we approach this topic today, the mystery of money. I pray and ask your grace and blessing now in Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. I want to welcome all of those that are watching live video streaming. We have some in our chapel cafe. It's great to have everybody part of our service today. So, what's your earliest memory regarding money? Think back for a moment. What was your first encounter with money as a child? For me, I was around 8 or 9 years old. My dad was a coach for a little league basketball team that I was on. And after the games, we had a tradition. He would take me to McDonald's, and I would buy a Big Mac, a fries, an orange drink, and an apple turnover, and it cost $1.56. Inflation has changed some things. They cost more, and the burgers are smaller now. I guarantee you they're smaller. The Big Mac is not, it's a Little Mac now. And I remember when it wasn't basketball season, sometimes I'd walk up to my dad and I'd look at his pockets and I'd say, Dad, do you have an extra $1.56 in there? And then he kind of cracked his smile and says, okay, let's go. Let's go to McDonald's. And he and I would go to McDonald's. That was a fond memory growing up for me. Our lives from an early childhood, money's intertwined within our lives. And really, for most people, money is a mystery. Money holds a strange power over us if we're not aware of it. You think you know somebody? You think you know somebody until you play a game of Monopoly with them. Then you really find out what they're like, right? Young ladies, before you marry that young man, hey, say, hey, let's play a game of Monopoly. Get his family and friends to come and be a part of it, and you'll learn a lot about him. Now, there are three most important factors that I want to share with you related to money, and here's what they are: the meaning of money, the making of money, and the management of money. Let's talk about the meaning of money. Money, it has whatever meaning you assign to it. Whatever value that you personally attach to money, that's what money means to you. Most people don't have a proper understanding of the meaning of money. Money has a spiritual dimension to it. Money possesses this mystical power over people because of what they assign to money. For example, when I say money, what's the first thought that comes to your mind? A husband just said his wife. No. A guy noticed that his buddy was just down. He's not having a good day. He said, hey, man, what's going on? He says, my girlfriend. He said, well, what's wrong? He said, well, I asked her the other day if she could learn to love me. And he goes, well, what's wrong? What did she say? She said back to me, how much money are you willing to spend on my education? Okay, that was a joke, but it went right over your head. You have a sugar rush, I'll forgive you. You know, before marriage, a man yearns for the woman he loves. And then after marriage, the why is silent. Okay. Right. You're not getting it. Yearns, earns. Anyway, my oldest son came out to me the other day and he said, Dad, I just want to know, how much did it cost you to get married? I said, I don't know, son, I'm still paying on it. So I couldn't help him very much. So when I say money, what comes to your mind? Is it security? Is the first thought that comes to your mind power, or is it love, or is it happiness? Or when I say money, do you think evil? When I say money, you think scary. When I say money, you think freedom. When I say money, you think validation. Or when I say money, you think opportunity. Or when I say money, you think a tool. Or when I say money, some people think it's a means to an end. For others, it's the end in and of itself. According to Jesus, money does have a spiritual dimension to it. Because in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, look at what he said. No one can serve two masters. For either he will love one or hate one and love the other. We all know you can't serve two masters. You will either hate the one and love the other. In other words, you can't be a Cowboy fan and a Patriots fan, right? You got to love one and you got to, okay, now you know, hate the other, right? Or else you'll be loyal to the one and despise the other. And then look at what he says at the very end. He says, you cannot serve God and mammon. Let's say that together. You cannot serve God and mammon. At this point in time, in this verse, Jesus elevates money to a spiritual status. He actually deifies it. He raises it up to the level of a false god. Mammon had never existed. This is a name of a false god that Jesus attached to money. So when people have an inordinate relationship with money, it can elevate itself to a position of a god in someone's life. That's why there are over 800 verses in the Bible related to money and the meaning of money, the making of money, and the management of money. Over 800 verses. Jesus had more to say about money than he did heaven and hell combined together. Why? He understood the spiritual dimension, and he understood how people assign the wrong value to this thing called money. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Timothy 6:10, "For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from their faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows." We've all seen, we all know personal stories of people whose lives, marriages, and families were devastated over the love of money. Not money, because money really isn't either evil or good. Money is just money. It's what we assign to it. It's the status that we give it in our lives that determines whether it is good or evil. Peter, the Apostle Peter, in 1 Peter 5:2, he refers to money as, and I love this old King James, old school, he calls it filthy lucre. Filthy lucre. So, money's really not good or evil. It's whatever we make it to be in our lives. When you think about money, you should really think of it as a magnifying glass, because what money does is money simply magnifies what's already there. You see, if a person's stingy, then money magnifies that person's stinginess and it makes them more stingy. Money in the hands of an addict will magnify their addiction. Money in the hands of a philanthropist will magnify their generosity. So all money really is, at the end of the day, is it's a magnifying glass. So write this down. Money will mean to you whatever value you assign it. Money will mean to you, it'll mean to your children and your children's children, whatever value you assign to it. So what value should we assign to money? Let's talk about the making of money. Now, our faith originated with the Jewish people. We owe a debt to the Jewish nation, to the Jewish people, to the Hebrew people. They are God's chosen people. Now, they need Jesus like everybody else in the world needs Jesus. Until they accept Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, they're not saved. And the Apostle Paul, who was a Jew, Saul of Tarsus, who became a Christ follower, stresses and emphasizes that in all of his writings, particularly in the book of Romans. When in Romans 9, 10, and 11, he elaborates on God's plan for the Jewish people, and he himself, as a Jew, said, "I wish I myself could be accursed, that my kinsmen, my brethren, according to the flesh, might be saved." So they all need Jesus. But we understand Jesus was Jewish. All the apostles were Jewish. The Bible was written by Jews. The context of the Bible, it occurred in the Promised Land, in the Holy Land. So we are indebted to the Jewish people. We understand that the entirety of God's Word is both Old Testament and New Testament. Now, we're no longer under the Old Testament, but we still abide by the moral code of the Old Testament because that wasn't done away with. But the ceremonial practices of the Old Testament, the feasts of the Old Testament, are now fulfilled in Christ. So as Christians, we don't have to go back to Judaism to try to get close to Jesus or close to God. So we understand that. We need to understand that. But there's much we can learn from the Jewish people and the Old Testament, because when I was in my Old Testament, New Testament survey classes going to Bible school, I learned that the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed and the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. So really, you can't know the New Testament without the Old Testament. You can't know the Old Testament without the New Testament. And really, it means two covenants, the Old Covenant and the New Covenant, how God dealt with his people in the Old Covenant and now how God deals with us in the New Covenant. But I said all that to say this. God's chosen people, because they understand the law of God, they understood the Old Testament, they understood the Holy Torah, which is the Old Testament, and they studied it. Did you know that God's chosen people, Jews, have never had an aversion to making money? Matter of fact, in the Hebrew culture, which is based on the teachings of the Holy Scriptures, they believe in the nobility of honest business for a profit. When making money or creating wealth is done in an honorable way, it is an act of nobility. It is an act of worship unto God. They understood. They had an incredible, and to this day, an incredible work ethic. Why? They took God's word literally. When God said 6 days thou shalt work, they believed in the value of hard work, not just for the sake of work, but for profit. This is carried over into the mindset of those who wrote the New Testament. The Apostle Paul, writing to the churches, he would say things like this: if they don't work, they don't eat. Because there were lazy people in some of the churches that were smooching off of the other productive members. And he said three things. He said, I want you to warn the idle, I want you to rebuke the lazy, and I want you to comfort those who are weak. So in the churches, Paul understood that there were some people that could work but chose not to work. And he said, I want you to rebuke those lazy people. So Paul said this. He said to Timothy, he said, if a man does not provide for his own house, if a man does not provide for his own house, the spiritual, emotional, and financial needs that they have, if a man does not provide for his own house, Paul said this, he has denied the faith, and he's worse than an infidel. So the Jewish people, they understood the value of work. God himself worked 6 days, not 3 days thou shalt work, not 4 days thou shalt work, 6 days thou shalt work, and on the seventh you shall rest. And they understood the benefit of work was to produce a service or a product that helped others. What all work at the end of the day is to provide a service to others or a product to others that benefits their life and blesses their life. Did you know the Jews understood this? This is not some prosperity preacher on television, you know, throwing out this, you know, saying things for the sake of saying things to get in your pockets. If you will send your tax-deductible offering to me right now, $100, put it in the mail right now, or click on the website right now, and then the windows of heaven will be open, and money will begin to fall from the skies into your lap. I guarantee it. Well, you're smarter than that, right? Right, you're smarter than that. No, the Jewish people didn't believe in some cheap huckster prosperity message, but they believed in prosperity. They believed, and they had no shadow of a doubt that God wanted to bless them. He brought them out of bondage. He brought them out of Egypt. He brought them through the wilderness to bring them to a land that flowed with milk and honey. That speaks about prosperity. So did you know many of the patriarchs in the Old Testament were wealthy? Moses was wealthy. Many of the prophets were wealthy. In Scripture, God gave some insight, insider trading you might call it, to Jeremiah. Because he knew the Babylonians were coming. They were going to ransack Jerusalem. They were going to take the people captive. They were going to take over the land temporarily for 70 years. He said, I want you to legally purchase some land so that after 70 years, you have that in your as your inheritance. So he taught Jeremiah to purchase land. Many of the prophets were very productive and successful in businesses that they had. Amos, for example, was a farmer. So here's what the Jewish people understood. Look at Proverbs chapter 14, verse 23. Here is an expression of wisdom attached to economics that every Jew took to heart. Look at what it says, Proverbs 14, 23. Let's read it out loud together. Work brings profit. Mere talk leads to poverty. You want to prosper? Work hard. And not just hard, working harder, but working smarter. Jews, God's chosen people, understood work was to produce profit. Profit's not bad. Profit's not evil. Look at Isaiah 48, 17. It says, "The Lord, thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, I am the Lord your God who teaches you to profit." Say that with me. Who teaches you to profit, who leads you by the way that you should go. So the Jewish people, they never had this ambivalence about making money. They never felt guilty about making money. They understood that they were mandated by their Creator, they were mandated by God to work in order to make a profit. Now, many people, they're not raised in a home like that. Many people were not raised in a denominational church setting like that. Many people came out of a religion or are a part of a religion that actually promotes a poverty mentality. We live in a society, we live in a culture today in America that rewards a lack of work and actually punishes those who work hard and produce. We've got things upside down in this country. In every movie, in every magazine, on the news, constantly, day after day after day, who are the most wicked, evil people in our country today? those who work to make a profit. Now, those who work with ulterior motives for self-aggrandizement and self-gain and self-promotion and have a love for money and they're pursuing profit for greedy ends, they are evil. But making money and making a profit is not evil, and God's people have never felt guilty in an honest day's work to produce profit by providing a service or a product that benefited others so that they could take care of their own needs, and not only their own needs and the needs of their families, but the needs of others. Now, I'm gonna shock the socks. That's hard to say. Most people don't wear socks these days. I'm gonna shock the shoes off of you here in just a moment. When you open up God's Word and you go to the book of Genesis, in Genesis 1 and 2, on seven separate occasions, God created something and he said, and it was good. And God created and said it was good. God was extolling the things that he had created. And then when you get to Genesis chapter 2, verse 12, God creates something and he says it's good. And look at what it is. Look at Genesis chapter 2, verse 12. Let's read the first part of this verse out loud together. And the gold of that land is good. Say it with me one more time. And the gold of that land is good. Turn to your neighbor and say, gold is good. Go on, tell him, gold is good. I didn't say it. God's word says it. And every Jew, every Hebrew young man was required to memorize the first five books of the Pentateuch. So just 43 verses into the Holy Covenant, the Holy Scriptures, just 43 verses into it, God says something that every Jewish person took to heart. The gold in the land is good. Gold isn't evil. What people do with what God created can either be used for good or can be used for evil. How many know that a lot of people use money for good in our world? And then how many know there are a lot of people that use money for evil in our world? And how many know that God wants his people to use the gold that he created for good and to advance his covenant in the earth? Do you know that Hebrew people understood from the very beginning that God created gold, he created wealth, and he gives us the ability to create wealth that we may establish his covenant? The Hebrew people have never hesitated to ask God for three things over their children and over their lives: health, peace, and prosperity. Amen. Health, peace, and prosperity. And you know what a Jew who became a follower of Christ by the name of John, one of the apostles of Jesus, you know what he said in 3 John verse 2? This is in the New Testament. 3 John, the third book of John, right before the book of Revelation and Jude, he said this in 3 John 2, "Beloved, I wish above all that you would prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers." Now, we're not talking about some get-rich-quick scheme. That's not what God's word. There's not some formula to get rich. That we're not even talking about that. I'm not saying that everyone is going to become a millionaire. But did you know that everyone in America, particularly, can become a millionaire? If you simply work for minimum wage and you start early enough and you begin to set aside like $200 a month until for the next 40 years, until you reach retirement age, how many know that you will retire? It's real simple. You'll retire a millionaire. Why? Because of a thing that Albert Einstein called the eighth wonder of the universe. The eighth wonder of the universe is compound interest. So, see, making money is no mystery. Creating wealth is no mystery. Did you know there's not a single occurrence in the Gospels where Jesus ever handed somebody money? Now, he had money because in Luke chapter 8, verse 3, there were certain women, wealthy women, who had been blessed by the ministry of Jesus, and it says very clearly in Luke chapter 8, verse 3, that they supported and funded the ministry of Jesus. Not only did Jesus need to eat, he had 12 apostles. Some of the apostles were married. They had families. They had needs. They followed the rabbi for 3.5 years. They went from town to town and village to village, so they had financial needs. They had a money bag. They had a treasurer. If you don't have any money, you don't need a money bag. And if you don't have any money, you don't need a treasurer. Guess who the treasurer was? Judas. And how we know that the Bible says that Judas was skimming off the top. Judas was actually taking money out of, he was robbing from God. Can you believe that? Who in the world would ever do something like that? I wonder. But Judas was doing that. So, we think sometimes money is evil. No, money's not evil. Loving money is evil. Well, Pastor Carl, I remember in the Gospels, this guy came up to Jesus and said, what do I need to do to follow you? And Jesus said, go sell everything you have, give to the poor, and come follow me. He said that to one person. One. He didn't say that to everybody. He said that to one person. And why do you think he said it to that one person? Because that one person's God was money. And I'll say what Jesus said. If money is your God today, quick. Leave church right now. Go sell everything you have. Give to the poor. And then I'll hire you. Come work for me. Amen. Okay. So Jews didn't have this aversion to money or the making of money. And they prayed God's blessing over their lives. And every Sabbath, they prayed this blessing over their children. That God would make you like Ephraim and Manasseh. Who's Ephraim and Manasseh? I'm reading through Genesis now, my daily devotional reading through the Bible. And Joseph, you know the story, one of Jacob's sons, and he becomes a prince in Egypt, and he gets married, and he has these two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh. And for the Jewish people, Ephraim, you know, represented spiritual steadfastness, and spiritual steadfastness, and Manasseh represented economic creativity and abundance. And they prayed over their children that they would be like Ephraim, spiritually steadfast, that they would be like Manasseh, that they would have economic abundance and creativity. So they've never had this aversion to working hard, working for a profit. King Solomon said this. King Solomon said, the crown of the wise is their wealth. The crown of the wise is their wealth. You know how the Jewish people for thousands of years interpreted that? That they understood that what God meant by that verse in Proverbs was that God is happy with wise behavior and he rewards it with wealth. The children of Israel, at the command of God, when they were being delivered from bondage, over 400 years of bondage in Egypt, you know what they did? By God's command, they plundered the Egyptians of their gold and silver and clothing. How do you think they were able to survive for 40 years in the wilderness? How do you think they were able to establish themselves as a brand new nation once they entered into the promised land? Because on their way out, they plundered the Egyptians of their gold, silver, and clothing. Now, the Bible says that the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. It is the responsibility of just men and just women to go out there and work, and to work hard, and to work smarter and not harder, and not to become a workaholic. Anything taken to an extreme can become error, can become sin. A good thing can become a bad thing, can become a sin in our life if we take something to an extreme. So we're to do it, and we're to have a proper balance in life while we're doing it. But God wants you to acquire wealth. He gives people the power to create wealth. He doesn't just give you wealth. Jesus never handed anybody money that we know of, because if he did, it would have been recorded in Scripture. What he did do is he met the spiritual needs, emotional needs, and physical needs of people. He fed the hungry. How? Not by just creating food out of nowhere. He took what somebody had, a little boy's lunch, and he multiplied it. He multiplied it. Slow down, Carl. Okay, Lord. But slow the clock down, please. Stop time in Jesus' name. Hold the sun. It's not going to happen, so I got to finish. So what he did is he met needs, but he didn't just hand out money to people. Sometimes the worst thing that you could do is simply hand out money to somebody. You know, give somebody a fish, they eat for a day. Give them a fishing pole, they can eat for a lifetime, right? Give them a skill. Give them a craft. So the Hebrew people plundered the Egyptians, and they plundered their gold and silver. But then what do? They're in the wilderness. Moses goes up to the mountaintop. And he's getting the holy commandments of God, 10 commandments of God. And while Moses is away, what do? They go to Aaron. They want Aaron to make them a false god. Because you can get people out of Egypt, but it takes a long time to get the Egypt out of people, right? So what does Aaron do? What a dummy, right? What does he do? He says, give me all your gold. They give Aaron the gold, and what does Aaron do? He melts it down, and out of that gold, he makes a golden calf. And here's a very powerful lesson. Don't ever forget it. We are to plunder the gold, but don't set up a calf of gold. We're to plunder the gold. We're to work for profit. We're to work hard. We're to discover our calling in life, our purpose in life. We're to become masterful at our particular craft, whatever it may be, whatever skill, talent, ability you may have. You're to allow God to bless it and multiply it and cause it to grow. Plunder the gold, but don't set up a golden calf. And finally, let's talk about the management of money. Most people, they don't know the meaning of money, but many people know how to make money. There are a lot of people in New York and a lot of people in Texas and a lot of people in California, a lot of people around the world. They know how to make money. They know how to make boatloads of money. But because they don't understand the meaning of money or the management of money, it ultimately destroys their lives. So there are four things about money I want you to remember and never forget. Four things. Number one, money is a teacher. Money will teach you how to handle the true riches that God wants to bless you with. In Luke chapter 16, verse 11, Jesus said, "Therefore, if you've not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches?" So God allows money to be a test or a teacher in our life to see what we will do with the unrighteous mammon, to know if he can entrust true riches to us in his eternal kingdom. Number two, money is a thermometer. It measures your spiritual temperature. As a matter of fact, you can know whether your attitude towards money is right by asking yourself this simple question today. Have you enjoyed the sermon so far? If you have, that's a thermometer, right, that says, okay, your heart regarding money is in the right place. Because here's what Jesus said in Matthew 6:21. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also, right? So our treasure's in Christ. Our heart is in Christ. Because where your treasure is, your heart will also be. So our treasure's not in this world, nor the things of this world. They can come, they could go. I've been rich, I've been poor, Paul said. I've had plenty, I've been without, but I've learned whatever state to be in, I'm content. I don't need possessions to be happy. I have Christ. So whether I have them or I don't have them, no matter what station I may find myself in life right now, I have learned to be content because if I have Jesus, I have it all. Period. End of story. We don't seek after riches. We don't seek after money. Money is a byproduct of wisdom, a byproduct of hard work, a byproduct of taking the principles of Scripture and applying them to your life over a long period of time, and then you will be a wealth creator. It doesn't happen overnight. No overnight get rich scam. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about how God gives you the ability to create wealth that you may establish his covenant. And it's all about Matthew 6:33. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Don't seek marriage. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Don't seek having children. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Don't seek a job. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Don't seek money. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. We have our priorities wrong. But when we seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then Jesus said in Matthew 6:33, all these other things will be added unto you. Number three, money's a tempter. It's a tempter. It will always tempt you to become its slave, putting it before God. And then number four, money's a tool. It's a tool. It's a great tool. Money's a device to help you successfully carry out an assigned duty as a faithful steward of God. It's a tool. It's not the end in of itself. It's a means to an end. And the end is to glorify Christ. The end is that all we are and all we have, all for God. The end is that we are a steward of our time, of our talent, of our treasure, and of our temple. So if Jesus is not Lord over your money, then your money's Lord over you. And you're either a steward of your money or you are a slave to your money. You can serve God with money, but you cannot serve God and money. Neither God is your master and money is your servant, or money is your master and you're trying to make God your servant. Now I want you to imagine that you have something really, really valuable, something really, really important, and you want to get it to somebody who needs it. So you wrap it up, and you put it in a box, you know, wrap it up, and you hand it to the UPS guy. I used to work for UPS. You hand it to the UPS guy, and what is the UPS guy or gal's job? What's their job? To take that precious gift, that precious, and then to take it to the person or the place that you are sending it, right? What if that UPS guy takes it home, unwraps it, opens the box, and then keeps it for himself? What would that make him? A thief. A bad UPS guy, right? He's just the one to deliver what you are sending. God has sent us his gifts. God has sent us his blessings. We're just the FedEx guy. We're just the UPS guy, right? We're just the mail guy, whatever. We're just the delivery. And so God says, deliver my gifts to your family, to your children, to others in need. Where do you want me to send it? He wants you to be blessed by those gifts, but not to abuse those gifts, because ultimately he's the giver of every good gift. Now, this past Thursday and Friday, my wife and I had the privilege of being with Pastor Gerald Brooks. He has a great church in Plano, Texas called Grace Outreach Center. And he's been pastoring that church now for almost 40 years, and it's a great work in Plano. He is a leadership guru extraordinaire. He's like a walking leadership encyclopedia. And he preached here about 6 years ago. He's going to be preaching again this next year. He's just a great, great leader, a great, great guy. So he has this pastor's conference every year. He caps it at 300. His target is to reach pastors of smaller churches, because the bulk of the 400,000 churches in America are not our size and larger. We're only a part of 2% of churches in all of America are 2,000 members and above. Most of the churches are 200 members or below. So he reaches out to these pastors and their staff. And at the end of this conference, at the end of this conference, every year, he blesses the pastors. The conference happens in October. It's pastor appreciation. He wants to let every senior pastor there know they're loved, valued, and appreciated. And he makes you feel that way at the end of the 2 days. And then the stuff you learn is absolutely amazing. So at the end of the conference on Friday, he had every senior pastor, everyone that was there and registered as a senior pastor, he had him go back to the gymnasium area of the church, and he gave every single one of us an Apple Watch. I mean, how incredible is that? I put it on my social media. I videotaped all these pastors going to receive a free Apple Watch. And I thought, it only costs $40 to register for the pastor's conference. I mean, you do the math. $40 and you walk away with great wisdom and learning and impartation and a free Apple Watch? Are they crazy or what? And he had to get up before everyone went to get their free Apple Watch. I couldn't believe it. He got up, and so gracious of both he and the church. He got up and he said, now, I need to say this. Each of you are going to get an Apple Watch. I need to say this, because last year we gave out a mini iPad. I'm going back next year, you know. So, you see, we gave out mini iPads, and some of you, some not those here now, but some people, put them on eBay for sale. He said, if we give you this good, out of the goodness of our heart, if we give you this Apple Watch and you don't want it and you don't like it, there's got to be somebody else in your world you can give it to. But please, don't take this as a gift and then turn around and sell it. You're like, well, hey, I heard my pastor say that God wants us to make a profit. There's a right way to do it, and there's a wrong way to do it. When somebody gives you a gift, now, I like bigger watches. I like more masculine watches. I'm sorry. This is kind of feminine. It's a little bit too skinny for me, but I'm going to keep it because I like it. I mean, it lets you know how many calories I burnt just now preaching. I'm like, I'm going to keep preaching, man. I keep burning calories. 187 calories over the last two services. I mean, I'm staying in shape while I'm preaching. You're not doing anything right now, but you're about to. This watch will even let you know every hour, stand up. Every hour, stand up. You've been sitting too long, stand up. Like advice. Anyway, then pretty soon the Antichrist will be able to give me a personal message, right? You know, that's what's coming next. Carl, go here. I have a message for you. Anyway, that's when I throw it away. Okay, I'm getting way off course right now. It'd be wrong for me to take this gift and go try to sell it. You're a gift, and you're not for sale. You're a wonderful gift to this world. You're a wonderful gift for others. You're to work for a profit, but you're not to sell yourself short or sell yourself cheap. Amen. And God has blessed you with gifts. He wants you to enjoy those gifts, or He wants you to sow those gifts in the lives of others to be a blessing to others. All we are at the end of the day, we're the UPS guy. Beep, beep. That means somebody's going to deliver. They're delivering something at your house, right? We're just the delivery person of God's. We don't own it. He owns it. So we value and cherish every gift He's given us. Some we keep, some we give away. But we never, ever steal from God or from others. And that's why, as Christians, and I've been practicing this since 1983, when I got saved in 1980, January 1st, 1980. But 1983, my pastor taught the meaning of money, the making of money, and the management of money. And I learned then that I wasn't honoring God with the first fruits of my increase. So my barns were not being filled with plenty, and my vats were not overflowing with new wine. That's in the book of Proverbs. And I began to honor God with that which was designated for Him, the tithe, the 10%. And I remember that first check I wrote for $16.50, because I made $165 that week. And I gave my tithe for the first time. I felt such a joy in my life. And I realized from that moment forward, all these years later, it truly is more blessed to give than it is to receive. Can I have every head bowed, every eye closed? Father, we thank You today that we can just get a taste of what Scripture says about the mystery of money, about the meaning of money, and about the making of money, but more importantly, the management of money, Lord, that it's a tool and a resource that a faithful steward uses to carry out his assigned duties this side of eternity. I pray, God, Your grace in the heart and life of every person at the sound of my voice today. I pray for those that may be struggling financially. Maybe they've been doing it the wrong way. Maybe they've learned the wrong things about money. And so now, Lord, a lot has been placed in their lap today. I pray that they would just take baby steps, one step at a time, towards the ultimate purpose and blessing that You have for their lives. And Lord, I also selfishly hope and pray they would allow us as a church and other gifted men and women in our church to help them along the way. Heads bowed and eyes closed. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, you could know His love, His grace and forgiveness, the greatest gift ever given. You don't have to purchase. It's not for sale. Christ is offering you eternal life by simply opening up your heart and inviting Christ into your life as your personal Lord and Savior. If you're ready to do that, then just pray this prayer out loud with the rest of us. Say it with your own mouth. Mean it from your own heart. Dear God in heaven, I know I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. There's only one Savior. His name is Jesus. I call upon You, Jesus. I ask You now, come into my heart. Come into my life. Be my Lord and be my Savior. I turn from sin to the true and living God. I receive His love, His grace, and His forgiveness. Dear God in heaven, You're now my Father, and I am Your child. Fill me now with Your Holy Spirit, and give me strength to live for You, serve You all the days of my life, beginning today, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Can we thank the Lord together, church family?